Riceville, Iowa, and Memphis, Tennessee, are worlds apart geographically, but closely linked by one tragic event, the assassination of Martin Luther King Jr. on April 4, 1968. Jane Elliott, a Riceville, Iowa schoolteacher, was initially saddened when she heard the news of the civil rights leader's death, but her emotions quickly turned to anger after hearing racist comments on the news and from colleagues at school. This experience fueled her belief that there is a collective responsibility to eliminate racism and inspired her to directly confront the racist attitudes in her classroom through teaching her now famous lesson, Brown Eyes, Blue Eyes. Despite negative backlash in the local community, Elliott's lesson gained national acclaim and its principles have been replicated worldwide, creating a turning point in society's approach to racism.
I think part of the reason that this was so powerful was that it was done with kids, and it was done with kids in a very homogenous white area of Iowa, and it was at a time that people were starting to think about these issues, and so it kind of resonated with people in a way that just hearing about other group struggles wouldn't. I think it made it easier for people to understand because these are people from their own group, they're talking about white people who are experiencing this.
The story begins in Riceville, Iowa, a small farming community in northeast Iowa. Riceville was a place where people knew their neighbors and families felt safe. Most of the town's citizens were white, Protestant, and had similar moral beliefs. This common background led to harmony among neighbors, but stood in stark contrast to the racial turmoil characterizing the rest of America. In the early 1960s, segregation still defined the nation. Jim Crow laws, which created nearly a century of racial division in America, had only recently been overturned by the Supreme Court's famous 1954 Brown ruling. However, while racist actions were legally struck down, racist attitudes were harder to overcome, and de facto discrimination was still going strong. Revolutionary individuals, such as Martin Luther King Jr. and Rosa Parks, with groups such as the NAACP, used speeches, marches, and boycotts to draw the nation's attention to this injustice. At the same time, white supremacy groups fought to keep the upper hand for white America. On the evening of April 4th, 1968, in an attempt to deflate the civil rights movement, James Earl Ray shot and killed Martin Luther King Jr. on a hotel balcony in Memphis, Tennessee, an event that shook the nation from coast to coast. It was also the pivotal event that caused Jane Elliott to move her convictions into action. After a few brief teaching stints in two different Iowa school districts, and a short break to have her children, Jane Elliott and her family moved to Riceville in 1964, 4 years before her bout with fame. She found a job teaching third grade, where she was assigned to a class of underachievers who were deemed unable to succeed. It was this group of students who experienced the transforming effects of Elliott's famous lesson. Jane Elliott's world was turned upside down on the evening of April 4th, 1968. Elliott learned of King's assassination through televised news reports while ironing a teepee for a Native American unit she was teaching. Elliott was both sickened and angered as she watched a news reporter question leaders of the black community and ask what she considered to be an insane question. "When our leader, John F. Kennedy, was killed, his widow held us together. Who's going to keep you in line?" She described her reaction to this moment as visceral.
"And I thought, this is the time now to teach them really what the Sioux Indian prayer that says, 'O Great Spirit, keep me from ever judging a man until I have walked in his moccasins,' really means. And for the next day, I knew that my children were going to walk in someone else's moccasins for a day. Like it or lump it, they were going to have to walk in someone else's moccasins."
She took elements from Nazi Germany by using collars to separate her class by eye color, much like the stars used to identify Jewish people during World War II. The lesson itself was simple. On the first day, people with brown eyes were on top. They were the ones who were better, smarter, cleaner, and superior. They were given special privileges that blue-eyed children did not get. The next day of the lesson, however, the roles were reversed. The blue-eyed children became better, smarter, and cleaner. To bring this lesson to a close, Elliott and her class talked about what it was like to experience discrimination. She noted that it was interesting to see the blue-eyed children on the second day, when they became the superior group. In their discussion, The blue-eyed students reported that they treated the others better because they didn't want anyone else to feel as bad as they had the day before. After they finished talking, she assigned the class to write essays on how discrimination feels. These essays were later published in the local paper, the Riceville Recorder. This news article was picked up by the Associated Press, which resulted in a firestorm of national attention on Elliott's lesson, Brown Eyes, Blue Eyes. Elliott was invited to make an appearance on The Tonight Show, starring Johnny Carson. What started out as a simple lesson to teach kids in a homogenous town in Iowa suddenly was much more than that. It was as if a small idea was forcing the world to listen. As a result of her appearance on The Tonight Show, Elliott and her class became the subject of The Eye of the Storm, a documentary created by William Peters and aired by ABC on primetime television. While Elliott's lesson had a significant positive impact on her students and was being embraced on the national stage, the reaction of the Riceville community was just the opposite. It was swift, harsh, and negative. Much of the community's reaction to the lesson was focused almost solely on Elliott and her family. Her son was beat up on more than one occasion. One of Jane's students, Rex Kozak, talked about the reactions of the Riceville community to Elliott's lesson and how they targeted her in-laws, who ran a restaurant in town.
The day before the film was shown nationally, they served 147 meals at lunch. The day after it was shown nationally, they served zero. One person stuck their head in the door and said, "You Negro lovers." The big thing about Riceville, Iowa, at that point in time, if you watch the film, you see Rokoff standing on Main Street and saying the famous words, "Relatively poor community." There was a lot of negative reaction to those comments. Then, how dare this woman put our kids through this? You know, that now she just made a spectacle of our kids.
Another student, Raymond Hansen, spoke of the positive reaction and lasting impact Elliott's lesson had on his own views of others and his belief in himself.
This brown-eyed, blue-eyed exercise is one that is an emotional learning that is seared into your soul and becomes a part of who you are, and you carry it with you everywhere you go, sometimes whether you want to or not. And unlike things you learn in school, like math or algebra, you cannot unlearn it. You cannot forget it. When you are in a position where someone is making a biased comment, it immediately touches you, and you feel that same experience that you had for me many, many years ago. And sometimes I'd like to forget it, perhaps, but I can't.
Obviously, Elliott's lesson had an enduring impact on her students and their views of others still today. Elliott's quest to eliminate racism did not end with her class. She has dedicated her life to using this exercise in schools, colleges, and corporations. Jane Elliott's lesson was a significant turning point in both her students' feelings of self-efficacy and society's approach to racism. Elliott's lesson allowed her students to transcend self-limiting stereotypes placed on them by the school system in order to achieve educational and career milestones. Additionally, the role-play method she used activated an emotional response from her students, causing them to make lasting, positive change in their treatment of others. Similar methods are used today for diversity training and programs to reduce bullying.
I would hope that the ones who have been through the exercise create a more inclusive environment, but also that they create an environment that is extremely uncomfortable for those who make racist, sexist, ageist, homophobic, ethnocentric remarks. They must be prepared to make that uncomfortable behavior and not tolerate it. Elie Wiesel said you must not tolerate the intolerable.
Perhaps Jane Elliott's greatest contribution to society was that she refused to accept the status quo when she knew it was wrong, and showed others how to confront discrimination in order to make the world a better place for themselves and for others.